This time around, we'll be talking about a slightly different aspect of this image synthesis that I described this morning. And to sort of give credit where it's due, Gordon Wetstein was really the lead on this real-time implementation stuff. But unfortunately, he's on vacation. So I'm going to be taking credit for it today. And I guess I'll just get started. So, you know, earlier today we talked about these static displays, these stacked printed transparencies, you know, something we can roll out of an inkjet printer like that and just easily layer together, something any hobbyist can do once they, you know, grab the code from our website. But the real goal, I think, for a lot of people here is to eventually have something that can react in real time and you know, actually give us a live light field display. So this is what we're basically trying to build in this setup, and we have a couple of difficult challenges to solve. So the first, you know, our first take on doing this is, well, let's just stack up some LCD panels. And so that's what we did here, is we basically went down to the shop and we said, let's, you know, we cut out some frames and stack up some LCD panels. And so we have four layers of liquid crystal medical displays, which are grayscale displays. And I'll show you in a minute what that looks like. So basically, we've created a light field display that works in polarization space. So when you put a polarizing analyzer on the front of that thing, you can then see not only an image like you would on a normal LCD, but actually a full glasses-free 3D light field with horizontal and vertical parallax, occlusions, specularity, everything you'd expect from a real 3D display. And you know, the neat thing about it is that we've also, coupled with this optically efficient architecture, come up with a computationally efficient solution to generating the imagery that needs to go on there. And so we go ahead and, you know, replace the color filters you normally find in an LCD with field sequential color to also, you know, simulate a real colored image or achieve a real colored image. And this is not something we implemented in hardware. Here we had what we call grad student sequential color, and I just put the color filters back there. But this is something that, you know, modern LCD panels are now, you're starting to see this commercially quite a bit. So this is not so far-fetched. And another thing I'll kind of preview here is another device that we built using a very similar sort of setup. And this is, in this case, it's a three-layer back to attenuation-based display. But this is a preview of what we'll be showing this summer at SIGGRAPH using even further advanced version of the synthesis that I'm describing today that also takes into account time multiplexing. And so it turns out, you know, with that framework, we can even achieve a better display than I'm showing you today, with wider field of view, higher PSNR, and basically, not a brighter image, because in this case, it's so optically less efficient than the polarization fields, which is the main focus of the talk today. So to move on, I mean, I'll just sort of review a little bit from my previous talk in case some of you guys missed it. But up until, you know, today or the recent past, the main technologies used to make glasses-free 3D that are not holographic are lenslet arrays and parallax barriers. And these things have seen sort of limited commercial success, but they have a lot of drawbacks. Specifically, they both have this spatial resolution loss drawback, where when you know, stick a lens grid or a parallax barrier on top of a normal display, you directly trade spatial resolution for angular resolution and severely constrain the quality of the display. And so earlier this morning, we talked about the layered 3D, you know, static device that can achieve full resolution in plane. And now I'm going to be talking about how we make that into a video display. So basically adapting not only the computation, but the optics as well to work with commodity hardware that you can achieve and build today. So we're not the first people to think about layering 3D or layering transparencies to make 3D. So Lumiere in the, you know, early part of the 20th century was using a focal stack to create 3D, and actually he was sort of on the right track, but without sophisticated computational hardware, he couldn't really get to where we are today. And A couple other groups have thought about doing multi-layer LCD stuff, but we were actually the first ones to, build a working prototype and analyze the performance bounds, which was, this morning's talk. So just to remind you, again, we're using this ray-based framework to analyze all of these things. So we start off with a four-dimensional light field data set, which you can conceptualize as just a 2D grid of 2D images. And what we do is we use a tomographic synthesis, where basically what we're asking the computer to do is say, we want the projection through some volume to appear to be each one of these views from different directions. So if I look at this, if I look at a volume in space, I project through it, and I want, here's my volume in space. Here are some images that I want to, virtual images that I want to produce from that volume. I can cast those virtual images as a light field and say, for each view through that volume, for each projection I take through that volume, I want the that projection to match that part of the light field that I'm interested in reproducing. So I know this was I'm kind of trying to reiterate this a couple different ways, because this is something I got a lot of questions about after this morning's talk. So really what we're doing is saying we have a programmable volume, and each view through that volume is like an integral along this line in the volume, and I'm just trying to ask the computer, how can I create a volume that gives me all of these different all of these different views when I integrate through it in different directions? And so it's kind of a weird thing to ask a computer to do, but it turns out you can do it pretty easily by using this medical computed tomography literature. There's been quite a bit of work over the last decades on solving this problem efficiently and quickly for lots of different constraints. And so this morning's talk, I talked about how we do this in the log domain for attenuation-based volumes. But of course, if we have a, here was the result, just to reiterate. The output of that solver, the output of the computed tomography reconstruction looks like this, where each of these things on the right is a different layer of the device, where I asked it to find layers that, when you add them up along different lines, result in these different images when viewed from different perspectives. So when we think about how to port this to an LCD, a spatial light modulator that we can just go buy off the shelf, I think it's really useful to just really understand well how an LCD works. So just in case there are some people out there who are unfamiliar with that, I doubt there's many, but I'll just go over it again. So we have in an LCD, we have a uniform backlight. It just emits light uniformly in every direction. We have a horizontal polarizer, which is something that converts randomly polarized light to linearly polarized light in one dimension. We have a liquid crystal, which for our simplified purposes, you can think of as a voltage-controlled linear polarization state rotator. So when you put horizontal polarized light into a liquid crystal with 0 volts, it goes through unobstructed, and as you go up to the maximum voltage for your crystal, it just rotates the linear polarization state of that light. And that's, of course, there are actually more sophisticated models to understand how a liquid crystal works, but it's true that you can actually build one that works very close, arbitrarily close to that. So this is the way we'll think about it. And then on top of the liquid crystal, you have color filters for each subpixel. You give red, green, and blue color, which your eye can average together into a nice uniform color space. And then at the very end of that stack, you have another linear polarizer. And so this is kind of the key that makes the liquid crystal visible to us, since we can't see polarization state. It allows us basically to turn the polarization rotation into intensity. And that's done by Malus's law. So this is a sine squared law that basically is a function of the angle between a polarization direction and a polarizing analyzer. And basically we can now, by controlling the voltage of the liquid crystal, control the intensity of light coming through the liquid crystal. So if we wanted to just directly port our layered 3D work to a liquid crystal display, we could just stack up 3 liquid crystals surrounded by polarizers, and we could even do a pretty easy optimization and remove a couple of the rear polarizers that are just redundant, because we don't need two linear polarizers in the same direction in a row. But it turns out that this is actually really optically inefficient, right? So what happens is we get a lot of loss in the polarizers and a lot of loss in the color filters. So, well, let's, for a start, just take all those color filters out. And that goes from, you know, 2.7% brightness to something that depends on the brightness of our the transmission of our polarizer for brightness. So the next step we can do, which is sort of the key to this whole work and why we call it polarization fields, is that we can then pull the polarizers out of the middle of that stack too. And now what we get is what you saw in the beginning. It's a whole stack of linear polarization state rotators. So there's no more attenuation in this volume. We just have this weird sine squared nonlinearity at the end when we put that last analyzer on. So when I played that video for you at the beginning, you saw me putting that last analyzing layer on and converting all of those polarization rotation states into a light field image. And so let's just look at how this actually modifies our attenuation model, right? So we get sort of the same thing. When I cast a ray through this volume, what I get, instead of attenuation at each interaction with a layer, I get a rotation. And that rotation basically adds up as the ray goes along. And so I can then analyze it at the end, and I apply this sort of sine squared law. So what I get, instead of that log domain, I get a sine squared domain. But then I can throw that back. Basically, it's a new error function, but I can throw that right back into the same tomographic synthesis framework that I showed this morning, and we can basically use the same body of literature and all of those existing algorithms on this synthesis as well. So yeah, that's the new expression, which you can see is very similar to that log expression that we had earlier. So just as a you know, means of showing the results here, this is the input light field on the left, and now we're going to decompose that in polarization space instead of attenuation space, and you get something that looks pretty similar. You can see it still kind of works like a slicing operator as the object travels through the different layers of the device, and for virtual objects that lay outside of the volume of the physical device, you get these weird and sort of unpredictable patterns that you wouldn't be able to really generate by hand. And so just to kind of explain what you're seeing here, we're representing polarization rotation by intensity. So as you go from black to white, that means, you know, that particular layer is either rotating or not rotating the light coming through it. And so you can see, for example, in the background, which is all white, for the most part, the back of the screen rotates it once to go through the front layer and then never again. It's black in each subsequent layer. So here are the reconstruction results, and you can see, just like in the layered 3D, this matches our model pretty closely, although in this case, since the LCD panel deviates a bit from an ideal polarization state rotator, we don't get quite as good agreement. But you can see, just to underscore the benefit of using this model over just sort of naively applying our attenuation-based model, this is a comparison of the intensity between using, you know, the layered 3D approach and the polarization fields approach. So this is just a quick summary of how we built it. You know, being at the Media Lab is a great experience because we can just walk right downstairs and we have an amazing shop with all these CNC machines, and we could cut out aluminum frames and stack them up to build these kind of displays. And as I showed you earlier, we are able to build that four-layer device and use a very similar technique to build, you know, this summer's three-layer device. And Now, at this point, I'll talk about basically the solver. How do we make this thing run in real time now that we've got a framework that works well on LCD panels? So if we went and just naively did this in MATLAB, that solver, you can use MATLAB's least squares minimizer to do it, but it takes about 10 minutes to run on a pretty modern computer. And so that's acceptable for these static displays where you just do it once and forget about it, but it's really not acceptable if you want to watch a video. So what we've been able to do is map this all of this framework to efficient GPU optimized steps. So steps that fit into the existing graphics pipeline on a graphical processing unit. And that allows us to basically run that same, basically the same reconstruction that we've laid out in MATLAB and used this really slow offline solver to perform on the GPU. And we can run it at something like 10 frames per second on a not very high-end card. So we got NVIDIA Quadro NVS 450, which is like a sort of a business and quality card. But we got it because it could drive four displays simultaneously, clock synced, so that we could get the same exact image, well, not the exact image, but the same image at the same time on each of the displays. They have to run in lockstep. So this is, again, kind of the result that we're able to achieve using that online solver. And you can see it's basically the same quality that you can get using the offline solver. So there's really no downside. But what you're seeing here actually is a downside of the hardware. So when you move vertically and horizontally, you can see differing degrees of moiré interference. And that's caused by the pixel grid of those LCD panels. So that's something we didn't really address too much in this work, but at the end I'll give you a clue about how to address that. So really there are kind of three components to that solver, and this is this sort of standard linear solver formulation. We've got the actual layers of the device that we want to solve for, so that's our sort of, we've got AX plus B, right? So that's the layers of the device are the X. We've got the projection matrix that maps a ray in space to a particular pixel on the screen, and so that's the A. And by the way, this formulation applies to the layered 3D as well, so the solver works for both. And then we've got the light field that we want to actually see coming out of the display, and that's our B term. So we're basically just saying, again, this is a linear algebra way of formulating this idea that we're going to project and get a light field coming out. And so there are a couple of steps. If we just implement SART, which is a simultaneous algebraic reconstruction technique in MATLAB, there are a couple of, this is a standard algorithm, but there are a couple of simple steps. And this is the key there, which is the update rule. So it's an iterative algorithm that you run through this loop a bunch of times, and you get increasingly better quality, but sort of diminishing returns for each additional pass through the loop. And this is, we constrain it to work only within the capabilities of the LCD. We can't have negative light, and we can't go above a particular value. So the keys there are the two A functions. So we, if you look up SART in the literature, you need to go, basically you need to have a function that solves that projection matrix, and we have one in the GPU. Basically we can map to these efficient graphical processing steps. In the GPU you have basically, projections are free because it's part of the graphics pipeline. So we just put the texture that we want on each layer, and we put the projection matrix into the GPU and for each view, and we just render them into a multiplicative buffer. And that's our sort of forward step. And the backward step is just map directly to texture mapping on a GPU. So we just create a virtual projector and project onto each of those layers. We're basically projecting the error back onto the layers. So those are the two important sort of GPU steps. That's the insight that lets us do this in real time. So you can see that actually it doesn't require too many iterations to get a pretty good result. You can go from zero, just one to or two to five gives you a pretty good increment, but then 5 to 50, there's not a huge increment. So that suggests that we can run a pretty low number of steps. And here you can see just a couple of different trade-offs where we run, just one iteration here, you get a kind of blurry result. You can seed one iteration with, the first iteration with the previous frame's data, even if you haven't rendered the object in exactly the same position, and then you get these sort of motion trails, but you can get a higher quality if the object's staying still. So just to really kind of conclude and summarize what we've achieved here, we've got this sort of joint optimization of the optics and the image synthesis. So we think about it as one big package, and basically allow the display to be much brighter by using this polarization space, and we allow the computation to be much faster by mapping it to operations in a GPU. So thanks again for your attention.